Okay, we are going to start with the chapter, the geography lesson. Okay, this chapter is written by Zulfikar Ghosh. Okay, what is the chapter all about? What are the things that we are going to keep in our mind while we are going to read this chapter? What are the various things? Each and every chapter has been given to you so that you learn about something. So from this chapter, what are the various things that we are going to learn after we finish reading this chapter? So these are what we are going to discuss in this section, which is called the objectives of reading this poem. Okay, first objective is initiating interdisciplinary study of language. What is discipline? Say English is a discipline, social science is a discipline, home science is a discipline, maths is a discipline, science is a discipline, these are Hindi is a discipline, all these are disciplines. Okay, so whenever we are doing an interdisciplinary study, that means using one discipline to study one other discipline, that is called interdisciplinary study. This is used mainly in language. When, say, for example, you are doing social science also in English, you are doing science also in English, and English also in English. So we can use the other subjects also to initiate our skills of the language, that is of English. So that is why it is called interdisciplinary study of English. We are having a geography lesson in English. Okay. Second point that we have to keep in mind is understanding the importance of having the basic geography lessons about civilization. Why we should have the basic geographical ideas about civilization is very important. And that is what we are going to learn in this poem, the geography lesson. Number three is analyzing how geographical things are actually affecting our civilization. How we are living, how these various kind of geographical things are actually affecting our day-to-day life, that we are also going to learn. Number four is evaluating natural and human constructions and urbanization. What urbanization is, how human construction have been made according to the natural procedure or through some human brain, that we are going to discuss and evaluate through this poem. Next point is understand and remember the importance of poetry, rhythm, literary device, and the power of expression. What is the importance of poetry in our life, that we are going to understand the rhythm in it, the literary devices that have been used, and even the power of expression. Why the power of expression is very much needed in the recent time and in future also, that we are going to learn through this. One second, let's just escape from this PowerPoint. Some people are asking for entry in the class, I think. Admit. Okay.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, beta. Please put your microphone off. So, all of you can see now this one?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Going back to the slideshow again. So, this we have done. These points we have done. Next, we are going to go through the basic things of geography that we need to remember while we are going through this lesson. The basic geographical things that we need to remember. Okay. First point is cities have been around for thousands of years. Cities have been built for thousands of years. Okay. That we have to keep in mind. Next is, after the Neolithic revolution, people shifted from a nomadic lifestyle of hunting and gathering to a lifestyle of farming and settlement. Nomadic lifestyle means like a lifestyle like the nomads. How do the nomads live? They lived by hunting and gathering. Gathering means collecting. Like a tree has many fruits, the nomads used to go to the tree and collect the fruits and come back. Or either they used to go to hunting and hunt different animals and come back. That was nomadic lifestyle. But after the Neolithic revolution, now you may ask, what is Neolithic revolution? Please write down in your answer book, make an asterisk sign and write down Neolithic revolution. This you are going to find out yourself. Okay, write down Neolithic. You have the spelling in your screen. So write down Neolithic revolution. You are yourself going to find out what Neolithic revolution is. Okay, so after the Neolithic revolution, people started living from the lifestyle of the people changed from hunting and gathering towards farming and settlement. Settlement means bringing up different small villages, from villages to cities, cities from towns, towns to different kind of metropolitan cities also. Okay, next thing that we should remember is, oftentimes people gather around water sources such as rivers and lakes and build non-nomadic or permanent settlements. Okay, usually in geography we have seen, like in Nile, beside the Nile River we have seen population, beside the Ganges River we have seen population, Yangtze River we have seen population. So basically the major cities or the major areas of settlements were either beside huge rivers or beside lakes. So water sources are very important for the growing for the growth of this cities or towns. Okay, that also you have to remember. Next is, gradually these settlements expanded and small cities formed. Densely populated settlements emerged along with specialization and division of labor among people living in the city. So people who were living in the city, they specialized their labor. That means a section of people chose to be engineers, a section of people chose to be doctors, a section of people chose to be teachers, a section of people chose to be drivers. So all this kind of things came up when people started living in a small settlements, and then they started going into bigger settlements and tried to form different cities. Okay, so when the cities were made, this kind of thing started happening. One second, we will just have to. Next is, trade, bartering, or other forms of economic exchange also took place. Architecture, centralized administration, and political structures all were formed of a city, formed around a city. So bartering, all of you know, barter system is the system of exchanging things. That I have a bottle of water, can you give me some food? I'll give you the bottle of water, you give me food. I'll give you a laptop, you give me an iPhone. That kind of a system. There, at that time, obviously iPhone and laptop were not present. They used to give, say, I will give you some rice, you give me some vegetables. This system of exchange was called bartering. So bartering and trade were different forms of economical exchanges that used to take place during the nomadic time. But later on, as people after the nomadic time, and as later on the people went on being evolved, so the architecture, centralized administration, political structure, everything started growing. Okay, so these are the different kind of geographical things you need to keep in mind always, actually. Now, some basic points about our city. What is our city over here? Our city is Kolkata. So before going into the chapter, we will just read a basic points of our city, so that when we go into the chapter, we can easily point these differences. Okay. Number one is, according to the 2011 Indian census, it is the 7th most populous city in India. The city had a population of 4.5 million, while the suburb population brought to the total of 14.1 million, making it the third most populous metropolitan area in India. 4.5 million only in the city, and 14.1 taking all the suburban areas. Suburban means the areas which are near the city and totally form the whole place. Like Kolkata is not only the city Kolkata, but Kolkata region means Palta, Ichhapur, Barakpur, everything also fall in the Kolkata region. They are the suburbs of Kolkata. So taking all in one, it is 14.1 million and it is the third most populous metropolitan city in India. People join so late. This is very much disturbing to constantly give entry. Okay, so we are going back again to the slideshow. One second. Next point is, located on the east bank of the Hooghly River, It is located in the eastern bank of the Hooghly River. It is the principal commercial, cultural and educational center of East India, while the port of Kolkata is India's oldest operating port and its sole major riverine port. India's oldest operating port is the port of Kolkata, which is the Khidirpur Dock, which is near Khidirpur, and it was the cultural and the educational system or center of the East India Company. So it is a very old city, but now as population is growing so much, we have seen that the city has extended more and more. Is there any person joining over here? No. So the population of the city is also increasing day by day. Okay, so over here we have gone through it, the points that we have gone through. Next is, we are now going to deal with the poem. All of you have your book, but still I have the poem over here. We will read through the poem and I will explain each and everything to you. Okay, so the poem says, the first paragraph says, when the jet sprang into the sky, it was clear why the city had developed the way it had, seeing it scaled 6 inches to the mile. Okay, taking up till this thing, when the jet sprang into the sky, jet is over here an aeroplane, which is sprang means jumping up into the sky. The word sprang comes from spring up means jump up. So the word sprang is the past tense of the word spring, which is jumping up. So the jet is, the aeroplane is jumping up into the sky. And as it jumped up into the sky, it became clear to the author that what became clear, that why the city had developed the way it had, seeing it scaled 6 inches to the mile. Seeing it scaled 6 inches to the mile means 1 mile now looks like 6 inches. As we go up, 1 mile is like 6 inches to the author. So as the flight went up, the author had a clear idea that why the city has developed like this, so much haphazard way, and a mile has decreased into 6 inches in the eyesight of the poet. Okay, next portion, there seemed an inevitability about what on ground had looked haphazard, unplanned and without style. When the jet sprang into the sky, what is inevitable? Inevitable meaning over here you have, that cannot be avoided. Whenever we are in the ground, everything looks so unorganized, unplanned and haphazard around us. But as the flight is taking above, we can understand that, okay, this building is made like this because there was no space behind it. But when we are standing in the ground, we are not being able to see why this building is made like this, or why this ground is a rectangle, not a rectangle shape, but a triangle shape. But as you go up, you can see the whole structure and you can understand why it is so inevitable. Inevitable means it cannot be avoided but to make the buildings like that. And why they are looking haphazard in ground? Because we cannot see the top view. From the flight, we are getting a bird's eye view. Bird's eye view means when a bird is flying, the kind of vision the bird have, similar kind of view we are having just as the jet springs up into the sky. Okay, unplanned, without style, when the jet sprang up into the sky. Now he realizes why it looks so unplanned and without any style when he goes up, because he realizes that this kind of building or structures or unplanned method had to be used because there was nothing to avoid it. Okay, second paragraph is, when the jet reached 10,000 feet, it was clear why the country had cities, where the rivers ran, and why the valleys were populated. The logic of geography, the land and water attracted man, was clearly delineated. When the jet reached 10,000 feet. Now the jet has moved a little more higher and it is 10,000 feet. And from there, you can clearly find out that why the cities, I was telling you all the important older cities and newer cities have grown near the rivers. I have told you about Nile. I have told you about Thames, around which the London is created. I have told you about Ganges. I have told you about Yangtze. All these rivers have given the food and population to make a city. Okay, so one second, somebody is asking for admin, I think. Gone. Okay, so So over here, he's saying that clearly delineated means over here it is shown. Delineate means to show. It is clearly shown over here. When the flight is 10,000 feet high, we can see that why we are saying that population grow near water, because there must be a water source visible over there and the population is very dense. And the author can see that from the flight, and why the valleys have been chosen for more populated areas, not the hilly areas. That also you can see. Hilly areas are so rough and so difficult to travel. Whereas if you go to hill, they will look plain. But from above, if you look, you can easily see the slopes and the cliffs. So it is very difficult for human beings to survive there. Whereas valleys give you an easy exposure to different kind of resources, which helps you to create a town or a city. That the author realizes when he moves up to 10,000 feet. What is the meaning of delineated? Delineated means shown. Okay. Now coming to the third paragraph. In the third paragraph, when the jet rose 6 miles high, it was clear the earth was round. Now when it rose farther higher, that is 6 miles high, it looked that the earth was round. You can see a half rounded structure of the earth from there, and that it had more sea than land. And as it moved higher and higher, you can see that land is very less, water body is more and more. Though this vision from the flight is not very often that we get, only if we go abroad, then only we can see this kind of vision, because otherwise the cities and we move so higher and it is cloudy down, so it is impossible to see anything through the clouds. If you have a very clear sky and you're traveling a long distance, maybe to foreign countries or something, from there you can see that there is a lot of sea over there and the land portion is very less. Okay, so next he is saying that, but it was difficult to understand that the men on the earth found causes to hate each other, to build walls across cities and to kill from that height. It was not clear why. So as the flight, the main theme of the poem lies in these few lines. That is why I've made them separate. As the main theme of the poem lies in these few lines, very much you all of you just can underline these few lines in your book. This is the very theme, this is the final literary theme of the book, of the poem that we have. What is he saying? That from this height, the author is quite high from the ground, and from that height he is not being able to realize that such a beautiful earth we can see from here, and we all are trying to cope up with our differences and trying to make settlements, cities and towns. Adjustment should be the only key towards survival of human beings. If we adjust with nature and with other human beings, then only we can survive. But what human beings are doing? Human beings are hating each other and drawing lines, that means drawing borders for each and every countries. Not it is little walls across cities, but it actually wanted to mean border across countries. And that for that reason, we are killing each other in different kind of wars. Okay, so that is what the poet is trying to mean, that nature is geographical location, natural facilities, all these physical divisions are so beautifully made by nature, and all human beings are trying to have these resources to them, and they should just adjust and have these resources to them with adjusting and sharing. But what we are doing, we are hating each other, we are pulling lines across the border and trying to say this land is mine, that land is your. When we go up, we cannot see those lines, those are not visible, and we don't even understand. The author is not being able to understand why do we make such kind of unnecessary decisions of putting walls across cities and killing people and hating each other, when the nature has not made any division in distributing its resources to its people. Then who are we to make the divisions that this land is mine, that river is your, that dam is mine, and this market is your? Who are we to make this kind of division when nature has made no division? Only we human beings are creating this division. And from that height, when we see the existence of us is so small, only so little land is available on the whole world, then we realize that our existence existence is very small, very meager. So why? Why do we go on hating each other, killing each other in the name of like, this is my country, that is your country? So that is the lesson that the poem wants to bring out. Okay, now so that this vision is clear to you, we have in the next slide one video which shows the rising of a flight, and as it goes higher and higher, how does it look from there? Okay, it is this flight is from Kolkata to Delhi. So just see and realize what this flight is all about and what are the things that we get to see when the flight actually goes there. So this is a video, I'll just start it. All of you can just watch it. You can see this plane has just taken off, and this 6 inches of 1 mile has become 6 inches now, and slowly and slowly it is moving above. This is our own Kolkata that we can see over here, and it is, the flight is going from Kolkata to Delhi, and you can see it's such haphazard buildings all over. The buildings are so haphazardly created, and you can see why, because there are certain roads going through them, there are certain ground, you can see a ground over there, it may be the some kind of football ground or there. So there is a haphazard and also sometimes planned. You can see triangles and all these kind of things, right? So the city is quite well visible, and the haphazard, you see the haphazard structure are now getting lines. See, all these the houses are in lines, though they look haphazard, but they are in lines. Okay, you can see the lake over here, beautiful lake over here. This is everything that our Kolkata has. Okay, so we are now moving over Kolkata. We are all, you can see the lines of building, though they look so haphazard, but they are actually arranged. This is our Eden Gardens, I think, or the it may be also the Yuva Bharati, the stadium, and that you can see over there. There is a beautiful stadium over there, and we are moving towards. You can see the river Ganga over there at the back. You see there is a river flowing over there at the back. We are moving towards that river. That is the river Ganges, and we can see the whole city has been developed around that river. And it's a valley, it's a plain land, and you can even see the reflection, the shadow of the clouds on the buildings. See the clouds above, and there are shadows of it on the buildings. At the back, when the, where the river, you can see, you can also see the shadow of the clouds. We are moving towards it. You can see that though they look haphazard, but here is a circle of this. This is some kind of housing complex. You can see some houses have been built, tall houses have been built over there. And the plane is taking out, the aeroplane is taking a turn. It is moving round, and so many houses, so many haphazard structures. It looks like white over from the top. And the clouds are looking so beautiful. Now you can see around, a half round structure, it is staying above the clouds. You see, it is taking a half round structure. Okay, so I hope this is clear to you. Okay, so before I go to this portion, that is the rhyme scheme of the poem, I want you people to just tell me if you have any queries. Okay. Any of you who have query can just put their microphone on and tell me about the query, and then we will move on to the other questions and answers and the rhyme scheme. Any question from any of you? Ayush, do you have any question?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Ishika?
No, ma'am.
Is it clear, Swati? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, it is clear.
Very good. Okay, now we are moving on to the rhyme scheme of this poem. What is the rhyme scheme of this poem that we are... It has a very peculiar and weird kind of rhyme scheme. That is why I wanted you people to know about it. That though the rhyme scheme is not very important, but we will go and see the rhyme scheme also. One second, I'm sharing my screen again. Okay, here we have the rhyme scheme. All of you can see, I'll just put on the slideshow so that you can see better. Okay. The rhyme scheme of para 1. What is there in the para 1? I want one of you to start reading. Swati, would you please start reading the first paragraph for me?
Okay. Sky, sea, bee.
I cannot hear you. Please put the... No. Please, not this paragraph. I want you to read the paragraph of the poem.
Okay, ma'am. When the stars in the sky, it was clear.
Sorry, your voice is not very... Your voice is not very clear. One second, Swati, your voice is not coming very clear. I will stop the stop this thing and will go back to you once. Your voice is not coming very clear. Let somebody else. Raghu, would you like to read? Raghu? Would you be able to read better? Raghu, your voice is not coming. Okay, Ronak, would you be able to read? Ronak? What happened to you all? All of your voices are not coming. Ronak, would you be able to read? Hello, Ronak? Are you there? Okay, your voice is also not coming. Very good. Next is Mahima. Mahima, would you be able to read? Okay, let it be. I'll read it for you. Wait a minute. One second, I'll just open the chapter in my phone. Okay, the first paragraph was, I'm sharing my screen again so that you can see the that thing. Okay, see, paragraph one is, when the jet sprang into the sky, it was clear why the city had developed the way it had. So the first three words are sky, city, and had. And the next line is, seeing it scaled 6 inches to the mile. Fourth line is mile. So A, B, C, and D. Four words. We have got four rhythms. All of them are different from each other. But in the next line, we are getting, there seemed an inevitability. So city, inevitability. City, inevitability. So we are getting similarity over here. So as we have similarity with city, we have similarity with city. So inevitability will be B. The first four words did not have similarity with any of the words. So they have been A, B, C, and D. We have named them as. But city is rhyming with inevitability. That is why they are both taking B. Okay. The next word is haphazard. See, about what on ground had looked haphazard. Haphazard is matching with had. Had haphazard. Had haphazard. So it is quite rhyming with had. So we will take it as C. Next is style. Unplanned without style. Style is rhyming with mile. Style, mile. So it will take D. And again, the first line, first word is getting repeated at the last. That is A. So the rhyme scheme. Haphazard means in an unplanned or organized manner. Unplanned and unorganized manner. Okay. So over here, the rhyme scheme is A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A. You can take down the rhyme scheme, all of you, if you want to. Otherwise, I am going to give you the video, so don't you worry. So A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A is the rhyme scheme. Okay, and coming to paragraph 2, see, when the jet reached 10,000 feet, feet is the first word, we are taking it as A. Next is, it was clear why the country. Country is the second word, we are taking it B as they are not matching. So A, B. Next word is, and the cities where the river ran. River ran, not matching again. So we are taking it C. Next is, and why the valleys were populated. Populated, again, not matching. So D, A, B, C, D. Now, over here comes the logic of geography. The logic of geography, country, geography, kind of rhyming. So we are taking it as B. Next is coming over here, that land and water attracted man. Man is rhyming with ran. So we are taking it as C. Next comes delineated, that is very clearly delineated. Delineated rhyming with populated. Populated, delineated. So both are D over here. And again the word feet is getting repeated. So the rhyme scheme is A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A. Same as the paragraph 1. A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A. A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A. This is paragraph 1, this is paragraph 2. Now, this paragraph have some problems and weird situations over here. We will just go through the last paragraph. As I told you, the last paragraph, everything is getting explained. The theme or the major thing that they wanted to show through the poem that has been shown in this last paragraph. So, the last paragraph, the first word over here is the jet rose 6 miles high. So the first word is high. Next is, it was clear that the earth was round. Not matching with high, so it will be B. Next is, and that it had more sea than land. Land, again not matching with high or round, so we are taking it as C. Next coming, but it was difficult to understand. Understand and land are matching over here. So we can make it C. And the fourth word is over here, that the men on the earth found. Found is rhyming with round. So we will keep it B. And see the last three words, the next two words, build and kill. They are not rhyming actually with anything. So I have put a cross over here. And again, why is rhyming with high over here. So over here, the rhyme scheme is not getting formed in the third paragraph. So sometimes that is what I wanted to tell you, that sometimes when we want to pose some meaning through any kind of poetry, rhyme scheme is always not important. The poetry that does not have any rhyme scheme is called a free verse, F-R-E-E, free verse, V-E-R-A-C, verse. Verse means poetry, free verse means free poetry, a poetry which is free from any kind of rhyme or rhythm. So sometimes what do the poets do to bring out the actual meaning or the theme of a poetry? They use the free verse. Just to bring out the word kill and built in the last paragraph to bring an impact in the meaning of the poetry, the poet has broken the rhyme scheme. So see the importance of the theme in a poetry. Poetry always will give you a theme, an idea about something. Okay, so poetries are very beautiful, which brings out different deep thoughts and inner feelings from us, which is easily shown or explained to people through beautiful words, which you can imagine. Say for example, when we were reading through the poem, the things were not clear to us, but as we have gone through that flight video, we could easily see that how the flight is moving and what the poet actually wanted to mean through the poetry. That looking at very far, when we can see the half semicircle of the earth, it becomes impossible for us to understand that when our existence is so small and there is so much other than only us in the world, then why are we fighting? Why are we killing people? This is the main theme of the whole poetry. And along with it, it also uses an interdisciplinary manner of teaching language. As you know, you are reading social science, anything in English. Only leaving Hindi and Sanskrit, you have read everything in English. So this is an interdisciplinary, each subject is a discipline. So this is an interdisciplinary way of teaching language, where you teach the English language through other subjects. Okay, so two major things you have to keep in mind over here. First is this poem takes an interdisciplinary approach, which means we are learning geographical lessons through English. And number two, it is raising questions again, hatred and war amongst men. It is raising questions about hatred and war among men and among different countries. That when our existence is so small, then how can we even afford to wage war against each other? When it is very clear from the natural resources and natural things that if we do not cooperate with each other, if we do not adjust with each other, then it becomes difficult for every human being to survive. Okay, so say for example, the whole world is emitting CO2, right? CO2 and that CFC and all this kind of things, the gases, the different kinds of global warming causing gases, the greenhouse gases, the whole world is emitting. Okay, but what is happening due to this emission? The ozone layer is getting depleted. The ozone layer is getting holes. And when the ozone layer is getting hole, it is the protective layer over the earth. So what is its work? It is saving the earth from the ultraviolet rays of the sun, the dangerous rays of the sun, the ultraviolet rays of the sun. It is protecting us from the ultraviolet rays. But the use of the CFC all over the world is creating depletion on the ozone layer. And in reply, what is the nature doing to us? It is melting the glaciers or the Arctic and the Antarctic regions, from where all the water in the earth is coming along. So if they melt, all these cities which have grown near the rivers will be flooded and human beings will be devastated actually. So we do not know, but we are actually creating problems for each other, and we are all a part of ecosystem bound like this. So if we fight and try not to adjust, it is only our fault and it won't be possible for us to survive for long. So it is highly needed this time that we are bound like this, and all of us, especially during this time, times like this when we are having pandemics and we are having earthquakes, we are having mental problems, so many problems around us. The poet wants to bring about the idea of unity and the importance of unity, that when nature has not made any preferences or partialities in giving the natural resources to us, then who are we to make this kind of boundaries and wage war against each other? That is what nature wants to tell us, and that is what our author or the poet is telling us through the poem. I hope up till this much it's clear. One of you just reply.
Yes, yes ma'am.
Okay, now coming to the question.
Yes, ma'am.
Now coming to the questions and answers. Yes, questions and answers. If you please, all of you just once go through the poem and just tell me if there is any problem. Go through the poem once.
Ma'am, what is the meaning of delineated?
Delineated means shown. When you're showing something, say for example, I have drawn something over here. I am delineating this to you. That means I am showing this to you. Delineated means shown or showing. Okay.
Ma'am, what is
it? Thank you, ma'am. Yes.
Somebody else was asking, what is meaning of?
Jet
is an aeroplane. Jet means a jet plane, an aeroplane. A jet is over here referred as an aeroplane. No such literary devices,
ma'am,
has been used. Yes?
Ma'am.
Yes?
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, what is the meaning of unplanned?
Unplanned means haphazard. Unplanned means something that is not organized. Just like my study table, which is not organized.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, ma'am, yes? What is the... Ma'am, shown is past participle of show.
Yes, shown is part participle of show. Okay, so I'm stopping the recording over here and we will discuss some other things. One second.